Good afternoon, I'm Giulia Guzzi, a PhD student at ETH Zurich, and today I would like to present a work that I developed in collaboration with Dr. Colombi, Dr. Dertimanis, and Professor Eleni Hazzi on the metamaterials for groundborne vibration absorption in pillars. The objective of this investigation is to tackle the effects of ground vibrations in buildings with innovative solutions involving metamaterials. Ground vibrations are generated by different sources, such as railway lines, metro, heavy road traffic, construction works, and industrial machinery. Depending on the type of source taken into consideration, the frequency range of interest might vary. In our investigation, we are mainly focusing on vibrations typically generated by railway traffic, which are characterized by a frequency content ranging from 1 to 100 Hz, and whose spectrum exhibits pronounced peaks at specific frequency components. Ground vibrations propagate in the ground from the source to neighboring structures, mainly in the form of surface rillet waves, and in some cases, as shear body waves. Within the buildings, they often experience amplifications due to the matching with resonant frequencies of pillars and slabs. However, in general, they are not a source of structural damage. Rather, they cause annoyance to dwellers, cosmetic damage, shaking, groundborne noise, and eventually they damage sensitive equipment. In order to reduce the impact of ground vibrations, several practical mitigation solutions have already been developed. Some of them act directly on the source of excitation, such as elastomeric bearings for industrial machinery or underballast mats for trains, which have the aim of decoupling the source of vibrations from the underlying soil. On the other hand, other type of measures act along the transmission path, like trenches dug between the source of vibrations and the neighboring buildings. An alternative consists in adopting measures that act directly on the receiver, like elastomeric materials used to decouple the upper structure from the ground. On the other hand, state-of-the-art research efforts point towards novel technologies based on metamaterials. Metamaterials are engineered artificial materials that couple with incoming wave and control its propagation by either attenuating it or by guiding it towards specific directions. Their main feature, which makes them so attractive for civil engineering applications, is that they are subwavelength elements. This means that they are capable of influencing waves much longer than their typical size. The majority of these studies envisage the use of so-called metabarriers, which are barriers of periodically repeated metamaterials designed to be either embedded in the soil or arranged on the top of the surface around buildings or vibration sources. Like in this example here, in which we show some figures taken from a startup in Milano. Here they have the aim of developing trenches digged next to railway tracks and filled with metamaterial boxes. Another approach investigates the development of so-called structural metacomponents. Here, the metamaterials can be either attached to plates or beams with the aim of reducing their vibrations, or the structural components themselves behave as metamaterials. If we think about densely populated urban areas where the distance between the tracks of trams or trains and buildings is quite limited, it might be tricky to implement the solutions involving metabarriers, since they might require wide spaces. For this reason, in our study, we decided to focus on the second approach, the structural metacomponents. Our objective is to design a metapanel to be attached to pillars and that should prevent the propagation of vibrations through the structural component. Lattice structures show an attractive potential for the design of meta devices for vibration mitigation. They are reticulated cellular structures obtained by periodically repeating a simple unit cell comprising beams or bars. It has been shown that these periodic materials behave as frequency filters, therefore capable of attenuating propagating waves. Lattice materials can be mainly distinguished into two categories: those with periodicity in two dimensions on your left, and those with periodicity in all the three directions of the space on your right. Here we show the most common lattices, which differ for the arrangement of bars or beams within the unit cell. These lattices find already application in different fields, like in acoustic, automotive, or aerospace engineering. Here they are exploited for their structural bearing capacity, for the attenuation of mechanical vibrations, or as cores in sandwich materials. However, when a trade-off between bearing capacity and vibration absorption is required, they are only able to address frequencies in the range of kilohertz and megahertz, thus much higher than the frequency range of interest in this project. The reason why we choose lattice materials as a starting point for the design of our META device is that they are lightweight structures that therefore would not add large masses to the existing structural components. Moreover, they are easy to fabricate with 3D printing techniques. For the initial design of our META panel, we decided to focus on the 3D lattice structures, as they exhibit more flexibility and efficiency in terms of wave mitigation. We investigated different cells, and we chose the so-called octet cell, since it was the one showing the highest potential in terms of wave mitigation. The octet cell is made by an internal octahedron with 8 tetrahedrons attached to it. The final constituent cell of the panel is a modified version of the octet lattice, where we add an external frame to the basic unit. Therefore, the internal part consists of the simple octet, which has the only function of ensuring vibration attenuation. And this internal part is enclosed in an external simple cubic frame, which provides vertical stability to the structure and allows larger flexibility in terms of material and geometrical choice. Hence, we design the two constituent parts of the cell in a way that they fulfill different functions, one for the vibration attenuation and the other for the vertical stability. For this reason, we also selected two different materials. The octet is made of elastomeric polyurethane, EPU40, a soft material that allows to attenuate vibrations below 100 Hz, whereas the external cubic frame is made by carbon fiber, a stiffer material which is largely employed in the fabrication of truss structures in civil engineering. To give you an idea of the cell size, here we show the geometrical parameters we selected as a benchmark for our investigation. The cell width is 12 centimeters, the thickness of the strut 5 millimeters, and their length 8 centimeters. So at this point, by tessellating the framed octet cell in the horizontal and vertical directions, we build a panel. I would like to underline that the only purpose of this panel is that of ensuring vibration mitigation, and it has not been designed to achieve bearing capacity, unlike previous applications of lattice structures that we showed in automotive or aerospace engineering. To prove the added value of the external frame, we performed a static analysis. We compared two panels, the one on your left obtained from the framed octet cell, and the one on the right from the periodic repetition of a simple octet. We consider only the weight of the structures themselves, and we compute the vertical displacements. We can see from the color scale that the addition of the frame ensures a higher vertical stability and minor sags compared to the panel made of simple elastomeric octets. which is instead characterized by a maximum vertical displacement of approximately 5 millimeters. Up to here, we have shown the general design of the cell, the panel, and their static behavior. Now, I would like to show the dynamic behavior of this structure. To do so, we started by computing the dispersion relations. Dispersion relations are a relationship between the frequency of the wave and its wave number, that is, the spatial frequency of the wave. The dispersion relations are calculated assuming that we are considering an infinite lattice of cells periodically repeated in all the three directions of the space. To simplify the computations, we consider a simple unit cell with applied periodic block conditions at its boundaries, and we calculate the dispersion relations with the software COMSOL Multiphysics by sweeping the wave vector, k, along the edges of the reducible Brillouin zone, represented in red. The dispersion relations on your left tells us that the material we are investigating is dispersive, and that in this specific case, it will attenuate the incoming waves with frequencies between approximately 65 and 80 Hz. Indeed, if we were considering an homogeneous isotropic non-dispersive material, the dispersion relation would have been represented by the color straight lines, which describe respectively a P wave and two S waves. In our case, instead, these two lines can be identified at low frequencies and long wavelengths, close to point gamma, where the size of the octet is so small compared to the wavelength of the waves that it behaves like an equivalent homogeneous continuum. However, when we move towards higher frequencies, the dispersive trait of the octet cell emerges, and the dispersion curves start to bend horizontally. This happens because the short waves interact with the detailed geometry of the framed octet cell. As I said, the curves bend until the point in which they become almost completely flat, and a so-called stop bend or band gap is opened. This region is a zone frequency region in which the waves decay logarithmically and are strongly attenuated. Therefore, our main interest is to design a device whose stop band covers the frequency range of the incoming ground vibrations. However, in order to be able to do it, we first need to understand the generating mechanism of the band gap. We can prove that the band gap here is generated by the localized resonance of the struts in the soft octet cell, and not by the destructive interference that happens when there is a periodic cell. Indeed, we see here that before the opening of the band gap, there is a clustering of flat bands, which is a typical feature of Fano resonance. Moreover, these curves are centered all around the natural frequency of an Euler-Bernoulli beam clamped at both its edges. This means that the struts behave as if they were simple Euler-Bernoulli beams made of elastomeric materials with Young modulus E and density rho and almost fixed at the two edges. This hypothesis can be further validated by looking at the mode shapes of the cell at the high symmetry point of the Brillouin zone. It's clear that the cluster of modes is represented by the local resonance of the struts in the octet cell. What is happening here, physically, is that when the wave encounters the lattice and its frequency content falls within the one of the band gap, it remains localized by the vibration of the struts and is prevented from propagating any further in the structure. The mode shapes also show that the external frame does not play any role in generating the stopband, and it only fulfills its function of providing vertical stability. Now that the generating mechanism of the bang-up is known, we need to understand the parameters that influence its frequency range. More specifically, we can identify a geometrical parameter, the relative density, which represents the ratio between the volume of the lattice structures, the lattice structure on your right, and the volume of an equivalent field and homogeneous cube on your left. Here we can see that the parameters playing a role are respectively the cell width L, the thickness of the circular strut T, and their length, which is, however, implicitly related to the cell width. In the next slides, we will show how the attenuation zone changes by varying these parameters. We start by increasing the width of the cell from 12 centimeters to 15 centimeters, and therefore reducing the relative density, rho. In this case, the frequency of the bang-up is shifted towards lower values. This happens because a wider cell is characterized by longer and therefore more flexible struts, whose bending natural frequency is pushed towards lower ranges. I showed before the formula of the bending natural frequency of these struts. On the contrary, when we increase the thickness of the struts from 5 millimeters to 8 millimeters and increase also the relative density, the bang-up moves towards higher frequencies. This happens because the struts become stiffer and their natural frequency increases. Up to here, we have shown only the dynamic behavior of an infinite lattice. Now, I would like to move towards a finite model in order to get closer to the reality. For this reason, we build a panel made initially by four cells in the horizontal and vertical directions. Then we excite it with an imposed displacement at its bottom, acting in the horizontal direction, x, fx. Then we measure the signal at the top and at the bottom of the panel, respectively in the green and red points, and we can compute the transmission of the excitation within the structure. The transmission plot exhibits an attenuation region between 66 and 76 Hz, which is a good approximation of the bang-up estimated with the infinite model, that was 65 and 80 Hz. However, there is a small difference between the upper bound of the finite and the infinite models. This might be justified by the limited numbers of cells employed for the finite metapanel, and by the fact that we are considering periodicity only in two directions and not three. At this point, we increase the numbers of cells in the vertical direction from 4 to 8 to 16. The transmission plot now shows that the maximum reduction drops at lower values, shifting within the bang-up from 40 decibel to 80 decibel. Therefore, as we were expecting, the growth in cell number has a positive impact on the vibration mitigation performance of the structure. To conclude, in this study, we have shown the preliminary design of a lattice panel for the attenuation of ground vibrations. We have proven the ability of the framed octet cell that we designed to generate a complete stop band by means of local resonance of the struts. And we have shown the geometrical parameters that play a role in tuning the frequency bandgap of the frequency region of the bandgap. As I said, this is only a preliminary study, and of course, in the future, some more in-depth analysis of the design structures are required, both from the static and dynamic point of view, and especially it will be important to investigate the coupling between the metapanel and a structural component, a pillar, in order to understand the efficiency and to evaluate the efficiency in attenuating the vibrations. Thank you for your attentions, and I would be happy to answer any questions.